thank you all for coming. Well, I was disappointed that I came here to listen to a State of the State speech, but instead got a Pat Quinn State of Mind speech, where instead of addressing the major issues that are still facing our state and a crisis that has grown under his watch, we heard a list of certain items unrelated to the budget, and fortunately, on a positive note, some fine acknowledgement of some of our proud and heroic citizens. But the fact is, the unavoidable fact is that he failed to address a growing budget crisis, a crisis that under his watch grew from $9 billion to $13 billion. Borrowing that has almost reached $6 billion, 100,000 jobs or more lost in 1 year under his watch, and the fact that his two answers to our budget problems has been to raise taxes on the middle class and to release violent prisoners into our streets and our communities. So there is a great deal of shortcoming, I believe, in terms of the issues that really impact the people of this state. So it was disappointing. The speech was, you know, in many ways heartfelt, and I know that you know, we are all proud of our servicemen and women, proud of our everyday citizens who continue to do great things for our state. But the state right now and the people of the state are looking for leadership. They're looking for solutions. They're not looking for diversions, and they're not looking for an explanation that is inadequate about the fact that our crisis is growing and the problems are mounting and the people continue to suffer. And what I provide, I think, is new leadership, new ideas, real solutions, sound judgment, and an absolute candor to what the state needs to do going forward. So the speech was disappointing in a lot of ways because it failed to address the most important issues facing our state: a growing budget crisis, job losses, mounting debt, and the fact that our communities are less safe because of bad judgment by this government.
How does he mentioned the $5 million? His tax increase would save or cut taxes for 5 million people, mostly low income. How does that not jibe, or what's wrong with that?
The governor had a chance to put forward a tax proposal that was fair and progressive, and that would spare the middle class. He chose instead to tax the middle class. And while he had three or four different versions of that, some of which had different exemptions, the common denominator between all of his tax plans was and continues to be the fact that middle-class taxpayers will pay more under Pat Quinn's plan. Contrast that with my plan, where only if you're making over $200,000 a year will you pay more in income taxes. There's a clear difference. Pat Quinn has consistently, under all of his proposals, put forward a plan to raise taxes on the middle class. And his efforts to cut spending have been, you know, most recently the idea of releasing violent criminals into our communities that are making our communities less safe.
But he says his tax plan is going to include the progressive parts, but the exemptions, just like you say, your plan, you know, will only be on those over $200,000. Why is it different? I mean, he did have to compromise on that plan, but that's not the new General Assembly. He's at the same place you are, isn't he, saying, I want a progressive plan?
No, in fact, I think, well, first of all, it can be confusing as to where he is. This may be the fourth tax plan, I'm not sure. So far, we've had three. But the common denominator to all the three that we've seen in black and white have been the fact that middle-class taxpayers will pay more. And that is unavoidable. Under my plan, if you make less than $200,000, you will not pay more. So that is very clear. Now, if he's coming up with a fourth version of the tax plan, I'd like to see it.
What if his closing comment, that this is not a time to be playing politics?
It's a time to solve problems. And when we have a governor who continues to push off the problems, said he wouldn't deal with the budget until after the February primary, now has asked the General Assembly for additional time. We're putting off the problems, and we're patching over problems with more and more borrowing. And that's not politics. That's basically pointing out the fact that we have a governor who refuses to lead, has not solved problems. Our deficit is getting worse, not better. And I think the people expect more. They deserve more. They know that this governor has not solved problems, has avoided the tough problems, and is looking for new leadership.
On balance, do you think this speech won him votes in his race against you?
You know, I have no idea. All I know is that it didn't address the major problems facing our state. In fact, it went to great pains to avoid addressing the major problems of this state. The fact that a $9 billion deficit when he took office has now exploded to $13 billion. The fact that he's borrowed more money in 1 year than Rob Blagojevich borrowed in 4 previous years combined. The fact that we have billions of dollars in bills we can't pay. The fact that we have lost over 100,000 jobs in his nearly 1 year in office. The fact that we have less safe communities. We have dangerous criminals in our communities because of a budget decision and a bad management decision and a demonstration of bad judgment in releasing violent criminals in order to save money. These are basically the examples and facts of Pat Quinn's 1 year in office and the state of our state.
You mentioned that. Go ahead, Mary.
Was this a feel-good campaign speech versus laying out any real initiatives?
Well, I mean, there was a lack of detail in terms of what we're going to do going forward. And so, in a lot of sense, it was trying to recite a list of a very small list of accomplishments and avoiding the major issue of the state, which is the fact that our deficit has grown from $9 billion to $13 billion. Almost a $4 billion increase in the deficit in 1 year under Pat Quinn. These are not harmless, esoteric budgeting problems. These are real problems impacting real people. The fact that we can't pay our bills on time, the fact that our streets are less safe, our communities are less safe because violent prisoners were released early, some of whom only served weeks in prison, state prison. It's clear that we've had a year of a governor who has been short on solutions, who has demonstrated poor judgment and a lack of leadership.
You don't have much time to work this to your advantage. How are you going to do it?
Well, I mean, I think people are really starting to pay attention now to not only the issues facing their state, but to the first choice that they're going to have as to who should lead our state. And so I'm not concerned about that. In fact, I'm really concerned about solving problems and making sure that we get the proper leadership in the governor's office.
The MGT parolees are under unprecedented restrictions, and they're going back to prison now in dozens because of a parole crackdown. You mentioned that he released these people to save money. Is that the best way to go about handling this problem, is to go pick them up?
Well, I mean, first of all, the fact that there now are maybe 100 more people of these criminals back in jail, I think proves that they shouldn't have been let out early in the first place, but also that whatever cost savings there were have been probably negated by the fact that we've had increased costs in terms of parole expenses. Now, they won't give us the answers to those questions, of course, because the governor's unwilling to be straightforward and to come clean on the fact that this is a program that was not only spiraled out of control, but he's refused to take responsibility for. He's been very inconsistent all over the map about what he knew, what he approved, how this was ever allowed to happen. He said he didn't know about it, the program didn't even exist. Then, when he was disputing the fact that it was a secret program, said it was widely publicized. But then a week later, said he himself didn't even know about it, even though it was widely publicized. This does not instill confidence, does not restore public trust, and certainly is not making our community safer.
His new campaign commercial talks about attacking you for attacking him, says that he was only for the release of nonviolent prisoners.
Well, I mean, I don't know what to say. I mean, the governor allowed a program to go forward that released violent prisoners, violent criminals into our communities. I think that's pretty much an indisputable fact. What it really does is it gives people an understanding of consequences of bad leadership, bad judgment, bad management, bad policy, and all of this under the governor's watch. And I think it really, really emphasizes the fact that all of our major problems, while they continue to grow worse, are not harmless problems. They have consequences. Consequences such as bills not being paid, universities that are stretched thin, and in this case, communities that are made less safe because of bad judgment by our governor.
Comptroller, the governor still says that he's for the release, it seems, of some low-level prisoners just due to the overwhelming numbers that are now in Illinois prison facilities. Outside of this specific program and management issues along with it, what are your thoughts on kind of re-looking at sentencing for, say, drug offenders? Or should there be